Okay, so welcome to the class. Today's topic is on dependence, tolerance, and tachyphile axis. Dependence is something that you've heard long before, I believe, right? Tolerance and tachyphile axis may be a new thing to you. Nevertheless, the word tolerance is something that you've heard in different aspects, in different places, I believe, right? People are tolerant to something, people are tolerant to this and that. That is something that you've heard. And dependence, you might have heard with respect to drug addiction as well. So we'll be focusing on the terms dependence, tolerance, and tachyphile axis. Dependence is, yes, it may be linked with drug addiction, with drug abuse, drug habituation, right? And dependence itself is either psychological dependence or it can be physical dependence. So we'll be discussing about both of them. And then we'll move on to talk about tolerance. Tolerance is different from dependence. Tolerance is like when someone needs to give a higher dose of drug in order to attain the same level of effect from the drug, that's called tolerance, and rapidly developing tolerance is called tachyphile axis. So we'll be talking about tolerance, tachyphile axis, and dependence. So the contents that we'll be discussing today is drug dependence, psychological dependence, reinforcement, the physical dependence, drug abuse, drug addiction, drug habituation, drug withdrawal reactions, tolerance, which can be either natural or acquired. We'll also be talking about cross-tolerance and tachyphile axis. Okay, so what is drug dependence? It refers to the drugs that are capable of altering the moods of feelings, right? And they are liable to repetitive use because the people who are dependent upon drugs, they are there in order to derive euphoria, right? And withdrawal from the reality, social adjustment. Okay, how many of you know the word euphoria? Right? Have you heard the term euphoria before? Euphoria is a sense of well-being, right? So people who are drug dependent, they might be using drugs for getting to the state of euphoria or getting the state of well-being, right? Some others may be using drugs for withdrawal from reality. When there is loss of someone, your loved one, then the reality becomes way too painful, right? So that those states may push people into drug dependence. Another problem is social adjustment. When people move from one place to another, or either for studies or for different reason, then people go into drug dependence again because they find social adjustment a problem. Drug dependence is a state in which the use of drugs for personal satisfaction is given a higher priority than other basic needs. And it is often in the face of known risk to the health. It is not that the person who is taking the drug does not know that he or she will be facing health risk, but nevertheless, he or she will be giving the higher priority to the use of the drugs. Okay, it can be either psychological dependence or it can be physical dependence. Psychological dependence, it is defined as the dependence upon on a psychoactive substance because of the reinforcement it provides. Most of the time, the psychological dependence is classified under addiction or drug addiction, right? It may start as a liking for the drug effects, right? Like, let's say people start smoking. Why so? Because they feel that it's something nice to start with, right? But then once they start doing cigarette smoking, what happens is that it progresses to compulsive use. The intensity of psychological dependence may vary from desire to craving. There can be a simple desire to take the drug, or there can be an intense craving. Intense desire is called craving, right? The reinforcement, we used the term earlier. Reinforcement is the ability of the drug to produce effects that makes the user wish to take it again and again, right? So as to induce the drug-seeking behavior. So psychological dependence is linked with reinforcement, and drugs can be either strong reinforcers or weak reinforcers, and it depends upon the kind of the drug that is being used, right? If a drug is faster acting, then it is more reinforcing, and if the drug is slow acting, then it is weak reinforcing. What kind of drug acts fast? Is it the lipophilic drugs? Is it the hydrophilic ones? Okay, if you remember.
Lipophilic.
Yeah, it is the lipophilic ones. Okay, so in case of strong reinforcers, it is basically the opioids and cocaine that are strong reinforcers, right? And weak reinforcers are drugs like benzodiazepines. Opioids is something that is obtained from, that is related to opium, right? So opium related drugs are morphine. Morphine, codeine like drugs, they are opioids. And cocaine is another one of the highly abused drugs. It is also a strong reinforcer. Drugs like benzodiazepines, they are called weak reinforcers. Benzodiazepines are one of the most used sedatives and hypnotics. They are used in order to help people fall asleep.
Sleep inducer.
Yes, sleep inducing agents. From benzodiazepines, it can be diazepam, or there are a lot many other drugs, right? Alprazolam, lorazepam, temazepam. Okay, now moving on to physical dependence. Physical dependence refers to a state resulting from chronic use of a drug that has produced physical tolerance, where negative withdrawal symptoms of withdrawal result from abrupt discontinuation or dosage reduction. So in the earlier case, it was psychological dependence, right? The person had a sort of desire to craving, but here the body itself has become physically dependent upon the drug. So the body itself shows negative withdrawal symptoms. If the discontinuation of the drug or even dosage reduction of the drug, then there will be negative physical symptoms of withdrawal. This is seen in case of physical dependence. So the discontinuation of the drug results in characteristic withdrawal syndrome, which is also called abstinence syndrome. Since the essence of the process is adaptation of the nervous system to function normally, it is also called neuroadaptation. And physical dependence again is seen with drugs like opioids. Opioids was also seen, had also linked in psychological dependence, and it also has got links with physical dependence. There is no fine line as to, okay, this is physical dependence and this is psychological dependence. The same drug can cause physical dependence and psychological dependence at the same time. Okay, so the drugs that cause physical dependence are opioids, barbiturates, and other depressants, including alcohol and benzodiazepines. Barbiturates are another class of sedatives and hypnotics, but then they are not much preferred now because benzodiazepines have widely replaced barbiturates. Stimulant drugs like amphetamine and cocaine, they produce little or no physical dependence, though they are being used or abused. Okay, let us look what the drug abuse is. Drug abuse refers to the use of the drug by self-medication. Right? So a person who is abusing the drug uses the drug by self-medication, and the manner and amount in which the drug is taken, it is deviated from approved medical and social patterns in a given culture at a given time. Okay. Your friends have come in again. Okay. So what does it mean? The given culture and a given time. Just think of Sivaratri, right? Here I've got a slide. This is the situation of Sivaratri, right? Everyone in Nepal, not everyone, but then it is quite normal to see people using cannabis or people taking bhang, right, during Sivaratri. But then that is not considered so bad a thing, because our culture at that particular time does not consider it as a drug abuse, right? Therefore, drug abuse is something that is linked with the culture and a given time as well. If you remember, during the hippie years, hippie culture in Nepal, right, that was in 1970s and 80s, it was very much possible to buy marijuana in the streets, right? So our culture at that particular time did not consider it as a drug abuse. So drug abuse is something linked with culture and time as well. The term conveys social disapproval of the manner and purpose of the drug abuse. For regulatory agencies, drug abuse, it refers to use of any illicit drug. Okay, this is the same slide I wanted to convey you the message. Okay, now moving on to drug addiction. This is a pattern of compulsive drug use characterized by overwhelming involvement with the use of the drugs. Here, the person who is addicted to the drug, he or she tries to procure the drug and use it under any circumstances. And even after withdrawal, most addicts, they tend to relapse. That's why you see that people who are in rehabilitation centers, they go to rehabilitation centers, certain times they spend their time there, right? They think that they are okay, they come back, but then they again tend to relapse. Relapse is getting into the drug addiction again. Okay, so physical dependence, not essential feature of addiction. Amphetamine, cocaine, cannabis, LSD, these drugs produce addiction but little or no physical dependence. That is, it is just linked with psychological dependence and not linked with physical dependence. And nalorphine, the drug which is used to treat opioid dependence, right, it produces physical dependence without imparting addiction. It has little or no drug-seeking behavior. Another term is drug habituation. It denotes less intensive involvement with the drug. So the withdrawal produces only mild discomfort. Those of you who regularly take tea, coffee, it is like the consumption of tea and coffee is linked with drug habituation, right? Even tobacco and social drinking is regarded as drug habituation until it becomes too regular a thing. Basically, habituation and addiction imply different degrees of psychological dependence, and it is very difficult to draw clear-cut lines of distinction between the two of them. Okay, we said that in case of psychological dependence, there is reinforcement, right? And in people, there is level of desire to intense desire, which we call craving. And in case of physical dependence, there is drug withdrawal reactions, right? So drug withdrawal reactions is linked with physical dependence again. Apart from the drugs that are usually recognized as producing dependence, sudden interruption of therapy with certain drugs also results in adverse consequences, and most of which result in worsening of the clinical condition. Like in case of corticosteroid therapy, if the corticosteroid therapy is stopped abruptly, what happens is that acute adrenal insufficiency may be precipitated. That's why during corticosteroid therapy, if you need to stop the corticosteroid therapy, then you first need to taper the dose of the drug. Tapering the dose of the drug means you give a lower dose of the drug for a certain period of time and decrease the dose of the drug in a likely same manner so that adrenal insufficiency does not happen. Similarly, when beta blockers are stopped suddenly, then it might lead to worsening of angina pectoris, even precipitation of myocardial infarction in certain patients. Okay, and if anti-epileptic agents are stopped suddenly, then the frequency of seizures might actually increase in such patients. Okay, withdrawal syndrome is also called abstinence syndrome, but it is the same thing as another term for withdrawal syndrome. It describes the signs and symptoms that occur on withdrawal of a drug in a physiologically dependent person or physically dependent person. So, drug tolerance refers to the decreased response of a drug, and in that case, a larger dose of the drug is required to produce the same effect. Let us think of something like we were talking about benzodiazepines earlier, right? So if someone is taking benzodiazepine for a relatively long time for inducing sleep, then after some time, what happens is that the person fails to fall asleep. Then what is required is a higher dose of the drug is required in order to fall asleep. That's called tolerance, right? So drug tolerance refers to changes in potency, higher effective dose required, or the effectiveness, that is decreased maximal effect. If the sleep was for an 8-hour period, now the time period of the sleep decreases to 6 hour, maybe 4 hour even, right? That is linked with tolerance. So it can be linked with either requiring a higher dose of the drug or the decreased maximal effect of the drug, or both of them is seen in case of tolerance. There are certain key characteristics of drug tolerance. One is drug tolerance is reversible in nature. So once the exposure to the drug is discontinued, we see that the tolerance for the drug is also gone. And next time you give the drug works fine. It is dependent upon the dose and frequency of drug exposure. So we just said earlier that intolerance, you need to give a higher dose of the drug, right, in order to see the same to get the same kind of effect that we had got earlier. And frequency of drug exposure, in that you might need to give it on a regular frequency, right, or you might need to give it more frequently now. This is same. Again, variable time course and extent of tolerance development between two different drugs is also seen. And another thing is that not all drug effects develop the same amount of tolerance. That is, even tolerance may occur to one particular effect of a drug and may not occur to another effect of a drug. Let us look into the reasons for tolerance. Right? The reasons for development of tolerance is one, pharmacokinetic clearance. If there is increased drug clearance induced by repeat doses, then that can result in drug tolerance. Another is pharmacodynamic tolerance, which is due to the changes in the receptor number or receptor function, and it is also due to continuous exposure to the drug. The another is physiological tolerance. Physiological tolerance is when homeostatic adaptation of unrelated systems kick in order to compensate for the effect of the drug. And the another is behavioral tolerance, or the learned compensation for the effect of the drug, which overall diminishes the effect of the drug. Okay, let us come to another topic. Drug tolerance. Now, drug tolerance is not equal to dependence. In that, we just said that tolerance requires increased doses of drug in order to achieve the same effect, right? And dependence is something that is linked with brain, right? The brain demands, or it adapts to the continuous presence of the drug, and thereby the brain seeks high drug levels so as to function normally. And this is dependence. While in case of tolerance, it is just that the body requires, or the receptor require, more dose of the drug in order to get the same kind of effect. That's tolerance. Okay. The tolerance may be linked with, it may be natural or it can be acquired. And there is a term called refractoriness, and refractoriness is often seen in case of diabetes mellitus with sulfonylureas, where there is loss of therapeutic efficacy. This is called refractoriness, which is a form of tolerance. Okay, innate tolerance is a reduced response of to a drug even before exposure. We said that in case of tolerance, a higher dose of the drug is required because of exposure, right? But then in some cases, there is innate tolerance, in that even before exposure to the drug, there is some sort of reduced response to a drug. It is because some individuals or species, they are inherently less sensitive to the drug, right? The rabbits, they are tolerant to atropine, and similarly, the black races, they are tolerant to the mediatic effect of the drug or pupil dilating drugs. Some individuals and in any population, they can be hyporesponders to certain drugs, right? Like beta blockers and alcohol, people can respond differently to beta blockers and alcohol. When I was teaching you guys on metabolism of drugs, I had talked to you guys about the HCN plus syndrome, where we talked about alcohol affecting differently to different population, right? I guess some of you remember it. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Tolerance, now acquired tolerance, right? This occurs following repetitive use of drug in an individual who was initially responsive. So the body develops tolerance to most drugs, but this is seen mostly in case of CNS depressants. Continuous presence of the drug in the body favors development of tolerance. It has been observed that significant tolerance does not develop to atropine, digitalis, cocaine, and sodium nitroprusside. To some drugs, tolerance develops, but then to some others, tolerance may not develop. And again, the tolerance may develop to certain actions of the drug and not to all kinds of actions. Like, tolerance develops to the sedative action of chlorpromazine, but not to antipsychotic action. So if you are giving chlorpromazine to a patient, then the tolerance will be developed over a period of time to the sedative action. The person will not feel sedation anymore, but however, it will continue to work as an antipsychotic drug. Similarly, the tolerance will occur to the sedative action of phenobarbital, but not to anti-epileptic effect. And tolerance also develops to the analgesic and euphoric action of morphine, but not to the constipating or myotic actions. Okay, there is another term called cross-tolerance. Cross-tolerance is the development of tolerance to pharmacologically related drugs. Basically, this is seen in case of structurally similar drugs. If two drugs are structurally similar, then if you give one drug and if the tolerance has been developed against that particular drug, now if you give drug B, the tolerance can be given to drug B even if the drug was not given earlier. It is because they had structural similarity, okay? Or they work through the same mechanism as well. Alcoholics, they are relatively tolerant to barbiturates and general anesthetics, again because they all work through GABA receptors. Closer the two drugs, the more complete is the tolerance, cross-tolerance between them. Therefore, partial cross-tolerance can be seen between morphine and barbiturates, which belong to two different groups, while complete cross-tolerance can be seen in case of morphine and pethidine, which belong to the group of opiates. So this is the same thing. Now let us move on to tachyphylaxis. Tachyphylaxis refers to the loss of the drug effect when given continuously or repeatedly, and this happens on a much shorter time scale as compared to tolerance. Yeah, tachyphylaxis is very similar to tolerance, but then only the difference is that This happens on a very short time frame, even in case of minutes, right? You see tachyphylaxis within minutes. So if it happens within minutes, we call it tachyphylaxis. And if it takes like days or weeks, then we use the term tolerance. Tachyphylaxis can either be due to desensitization to a drug as well. Right? This is presumed to be consequence of diminished receptor sensitivity in response to consistent stimulation by a drug. And due to consistent stimulation by a drug agonist, what happens is that there is diminished pharmacological response as a consequence, and this is seen in case of tachyphylaxis. Okay, now let us look into the features of tachyphylaxis. It is not dose dependent like the case of tolerance. In case of tolerance, if you increase the dose of the drug, you got the same initial response. But in case of tachyphylaxis, even increasing the dose of the drug will not give the same response. So it is not dose dependent. And this is rate sensitive in that it requires frequent dosing, and continuous dosing will cause tachyphylaxis within minutes, as I told you earlier, right? And after a relatively short period of withholding the drug, the effect is restored again. So what you need to do in case of tachyphylaxis is that you need to stop the drug for a certain time frame, and then the tachyphylaxis will be resolved on its own. Okay, let us look at other cardinal features: repeat administration of the drug or continuously giving the drug, right? The same dose, it is not dose dependent, diminished physiological effect, develops over a short period of time, not dose dependent, and rate sensitive. Okay. Tachyphylaxis is mostly seen with indirectly acting drugs. Indirectly acting drugs means the drugs like ephedrine, tyramine, nicotine, they do not act on their own. They act indirectly. Okay, let us see the example of ephedrine. Ephedrine is a sympathomimetic agent, and what it basically does is it increases the secretion of noradrenaline through adrenergic nerve endings. So if you give ephedrine continuously, so what happens is that it will release all the noradrenaline present in the synaptic vesicle, and after a certain time frame, all the noradrenaline will already be secreted. So if you give ephedrine now, there will be no response, or there will be decreased response. Why? Because there is no more noradrenaline left to secrete, right? So this is called tachyphylaxis. And how can we resolve it? We resolve this by giving the drug after a certain time frame, that is by letting noradrenaline to be resynthesized again and come into the vesicles, storage vesicles. Once they are resynthesized and they are stored in the storage vesicles, if you give ephedrine again, now you get the same kind of response. Okay, we just talked about this. Okay, tachyphylaxis is also known to be seen with nitroglycerin on long-term basis. And this is because the enzymatic machinery that is responsible for the transformation of into nitric oxide is depleted. And that is why nitroglycerin develops tachyphylaxis. But then mostly, if you are asked the example of tachyphylaxis, go for indirectly acting drugs. But then there are a lot many other drugs that show tachyphylaxis. Don't just take the name of nitroglycerin straight away. First go to ephedrine and tyramine, nicotine-like drugs. In other cases, you can come to nitroglycerin, but because this is not even as an example of tachyphylaxis in many cases, but only few books refer to nitroglycerin when it comes to tachyphylaxis. Okay, and once you wait for durations of time like drug-free intervals, ideally 12 hours, typically overnight, for this to start working again. Tachyphylaxis is also a major concern with the use of topical corticosteroids and steroids that tend to lose their therapeutic effect after constant period. Okay, the other mechanisms that are involved in tachyphylaxis are slow dissociation of drug from the receptor, desensitization or internalization, down regulation of the receptor, and compensator or homeostatic adaptation. So the other terms that are linked with tachyphylaxis is adaptation, desensitization that we talked about, receptor down regulation, and refractoriness. Desensitization, as we said, It is the consequences of diminished receptor sensitivity because of consistent stimulation by the drug agonist, right? And this produces diminished pharmacological response as a consequence. The desensitization can be due to decrease in the number of receptors and or attenuation in the response because the drug has promoted neurotransmitter release in excess of presynaptic production.